We chose this theme advance, oh, I don't know, maybe 6-8 months ago, as a theme for sort of in-house, introspective revival, renewal, with the idea being this. The picture that God paints of the church in Scripture, the picture that Jesus gives us of the church that He purchased with His blood, the church that is His bride, is a church that prevails. So our mindset from the beginning is this: a church ought not be on its heels in defensive posture with the world knocking its breath out of it every day and setting it back farther and farther and losing ground to the culture. But the biblical picture of a church is a prevailing one. It's pushing forward. It's pushing out darkness with light. It's regaining territory that the enemy has taken. It's capturing the captives and setting them free. You know, a church that's advancing. So if you think about that's what's natural, okay, that's normal, then my next thought was this: what are those things that hinder that? What are the things that hinder a prevailing, advancing sort of church? So I begin to look at scriptures and thoughts and ideas, and it's always much harder for me when you're doing a message series, when you're just trying to look at topics and themes, because the Bible is so rich and so deep that you could never mine it in a lifetime of sermons. So we're going to pray about, God, what would you show us? Well, then Dr. Traylor challenged us in three areas last night. And really only beginning to scratch the surface of those things, areas that we really need to take to heart, honestly. Things we need to carefully consider as a church. You know, a church that is beyond middle age as far as churches go, and past 50s, he said. Things that affect an established church. I won't use the term Ted used, an old church. You know, his challenges coincide a little bit with an article that I read this week. A guy used these three simple categories to objectify the stages of a church's rise and fall. He used three words to describe them. Here's what he said. First stage, movement. A healthy church, he says, is born as a burst of positive gospel energy. And some of you were around in the beginning stages of the church here at Calvary, when it was a positive burst of gospel energy, when someone, some group of people, under the leadership of God's Spirit, presumably saw the need to plant a church over here in this community. And there was a movement there, an explosion, he says, like Pentecost. That's the beginning stage. He said, consider the trajectory steep and upward. I mean, the church has taken off its movement. He said the second stage, though, is monument. Monument, he says, is given human weakness after a time, the movement becomes more of a monument. The spirit of the church changes from hunger to self-satisfaction, from eagerness to routine, from daring new steps of faith to maintaining status quo, from being outwardly focused to being ingrown, and it's easy not to notice, he says. He says the self-image of the church might still be one of vital movement, but deep within, everything has changed. He said, think of this as just the leveling off. But the leveling off is left unchecked. He says it never stays that way, because the movement of a church is always dynamic. So something is always happening. He says the third stage, unchecked, is mausoleum. You go from movement to monument to mausoleum. He says if the trend toward mediocrity is not arrested, the church will decline and it will become a mausoleum or a place of death. He says the church as an institution may have enough social momentum. In other words, people still like it, right? They still come for lots of different reasons. It meets certain social needs. And financial resources, it's not broke. It can continue for a while and the machine can turn. But he says, as a force for newness of life, it no longer counts. Think of steep decline, indeed a death spiral. So Ted leaves us with these challenges last night to combat that. Challenges of a old church, a maturing church or an established church, forgotten faith. Somehow you forget what it was like when you came to Christ. And you forgot the enthusiasm and the passion of it, or you forgot what happened when the movement was young and it was exciting and you couldn't wait to tell folks. Bitter believers. Something happens in people's minds and hearts and attitudes when it begins to be much less about what God wants and what people need and becomes about what I prefer. And when I don't get it, well, I complain, and bitterness grows like a root and it chokes life out. And then he said the challenge of multiple generations, because you know, Let's face it, we don't always like the same things, and we don't talk the same language sometimes. We don't perceive the same sort of things. How do you minister across the board, across every generation? Now, I was thinking now in hindsight, next time we do one of these advanced sort of series, I'm going to have somebody like Ted come last so I don't have to follow him. Everybody last night was catching me after, oh, that was such a great service. He is such a wonderful speaker. I could listen to him all night. He's so funny, isn't he? He's so insightful. And I'm thinking, yes, yes, I hear you. I get it already. But here's the challenge. Tonight I'm going to expound a bit on that first one. The faith that used to be and the faith that God calls us to again, normal sort of faith. But before I do, I want to introduce you to a character in Scripture. A character you may or may not be well acquainted with. But I want to tell you a little bit of a story to set the stage for what I want to talk to you about tonight, which I promise you is going to be a bit unusual. It's a different sort of message than I've preached before and a text I've never taught on before. Let's talk a minute about Jeremiah. In fact, if you've got a Bible, you can open up to Jeremiah because I'm going to hit a couple of passages in there in a moment. Jeremiah had a hard job. And I know I'm speaking not to the choir, I'm speaking to the preacher, to the preachers, or anyone who hears this who would be a preacher, but man, I'm going to tell you what, if you ever complain about the job, you just got to spend a couple minutes looking at Jeremiah. Jeremiah didn't even have a choice in the matter. Jeremiah chapter 1 verse 5 says, God chose him before he was even born. In your mother's womb, I knew you and I called you to be a prophet. Jeremiah responded in the next couple of verses, chapter 1 verse 6 and 7, you won't be able to keep up with me in this part, so just listen. Verse 6 and 7, he responds to that call that he didn't have a choice in the matter, and he tells God, you know, I'm really pretty young here, and I'm not a very good talker. Maybe I'm not your guy. Maybe I'm not the guy for this. He was also probably more than a little bit afraid of what that calling entailed, being a prophet, because God tells him in verse 8, hey, don't be afraid, Jeremiah. I mean, that's always a good first sign, right? Don't be scared. Scared? I wasn't scared until you told me not to be scared. What am I supposed to be scared of? And then God tells Jeremiah what he's going to do. I'm going to judge the people, he says. In essence, he says, I'm going to break them. I'm going to break them so I can bring them back. And you're going to be my mouthpiece. And you're going to say things that people are going to hate to hear. And he tells them in verse 17, he said, Jeremiah, you better get your boots on and get dressed up for work because this is going to be hard. This isn't going to be easy. You're not going to be patted on the back for this stuff. You're not going to be praised. Somebody told me Sunday morning after the message, I appreciate you, and I appreciate being appreciated, so thank you for appreciating me. I appreciate what you do. Thank you for preaching to us. And I said, you know what? I got to be honest with you. You don't have to appreciate me a bit for Sunday morning. That's the part I love. That's the easy part. If all I could do was just preach messages, I would be in heaven. You know, if I could just prepare sermons and preach them, thank me for the stuff I do Monday through Friday. Thank me for that part. That's the hard part. God tells Jeremiah, this is work. Okay? In fact, he tells him in verse 19, the people are going to hate the message, and he says in no uncertain terms, Jeremiah, they're going to fight against you. They're going to fight against you for what I'm going to give you to say. Then over the next 11 chapters, God really lays it out. Here's your rapid-fire overview. Chapter 2, verse 13, he says, my people have forsaken me. Chapter 2, verse 32, he says, they've forgotten me. Chapter 3, verse 1, he says, they've been unfaithful to me. Chapter 4, verse 22, he says, they don't know me. Chapter 5, verse 21, he says, they've got eyes to see, but they don't see. They've got ears to hear, and they don't hear. Chapter 7, verse 13, though Jeremiah speaks persistently to them, they don't listen. Chapter 8, verse 5, though he preached passionately to them, they don't respond. Chapter 9, verse 3, God says, they're doing evil upon evil. It's getting worse and worse, deception upon deception. Chapter 11, verse 8, though they are solemnly warned, Jeremiah says to them over and over, thus saith the Lord, they are relentlessly stubborn. And finally, at the end of chapter 12, verse 17, he says this to Jeremiah, if any nation will not listen, then I will utterly pluck it up and destroy it. If any nation will not listen, if any people will not listen, I will pluck them up and destroy them if my people will not listen. Because God has made it clear these are His people. And Jeremiah's His prophet, and God's calling him back. He says, but you know, if they won't hear the message, if they won't respond to the warnings, if they won't see what I'm doing, then what can I do? What would it take for them to get it? What would it take for them to see and hear? What would it take for them to have the anguish that God says they lack? You know, if I'm Jeremiah at this stage, I'm out of sermons. I'm throwing up my hands. God, I don't know what else to do. I mean, I've cried. I have wept. I have sobbed over them. I've poured my heart out. I've spoken words that burn in my gut, Jeremiah says. But they don't hear. So God gives them a picture. God gives them an illustration in something that is so, well, honestly, it's so startling, and it's so gritty, and it's so coarse and down to earth that they can't forget it. And it's a picture that then, just as now, many centuries later, has real potential to offend people. He gives them an object lesson. It's a picture of underwear. I told you guys, if you read my Facebook, I said, this is the strangest message I've ever preached. A message about old underwear. I mean, Ted gives you these lofty things. I'm preaching about underwear tonight. But that's what Jeremiah 13 is about. And I want us to read the text together. But before we do, I'm asking that God would speak to us through it. God helps us to see ourselves in it. See which character we really are in this story. And see God in it. Will you pray with me tonight? Father, we are dependent on you. That's it. That's the bottom line. We are dependent on you. Because we are not different than those people then. I mean, our circumstances are a bit different. The world we live in looks different. But our hearts, we're the same. We're the same sort of people. People are people. And problems are problems. And life is life. And family is family. And probably a lot more parallels than we would even care to admit. So, Father, it's possible, I know, for us to be people who have ears but don't really hear, eyes that don't really see, and a message that doesn't sink in, or it's easy. We could be this. But God, I also know we have something in common with those people. We are your people. You've promised not to forsake us. You said we're a chosen people, a holy people. We've been given your name. We are your sons and daughters. We're not different from Israel. In fact, if anything, we're better. The new Israel. And Father, I pray that tonight you'll show us the kind of people we ought to be and show us what you want to do in us and for us and through us. And God, you do something that shakes us as a church and changes us, but also does the same for us as people. So God, we're looking at a text that's hard. It's kind of hard to understand and harder to accept. But God, show us what each of us need to see in it. Whatever there is for us, give it to us, God. Bring us out on the other side better. I'm more like Christ. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Here we go. Jeremiah 13, verse 1. Thus says the Lord to me, go and buy a linen loincloth and put it around your waist and do not dip it in water. Okay. I don't know what kind of version of Scripture you got, but if your version of Scripture tries to soften what a linen loincloth is, I'm sorry, it misleads you. Linen loincloth was the boxer shorts of Jeremiah's age. He says, I want you to take a linen loincloth, and he says, and I want you to put it on, but here's the deal. I want you to wear this thing. Don't wash it. Don't wash it, Jeremiah. Just wear it. Wear these underwear every day. Do what I tell you to do, and don't take them off, and don't wash them. Verse 2. So I bought a loincloth, according to the word of the Lord, and I put it around my waist. And the word of the Lord came to me a second time. Take the loincloth that you have bought, which is around your waist, and arise, go to the Euphrates, and hide it there in the cleft of the rock. I don't know what Jeremiah was thinking, because we don't get a look behind the scenes, so there are no bubbles here with the little dots going from his head, so we know what was going on. But here's what I'd be thinking. God, Euphrates is 250 miles away. That's a long walk or camel ride or whatever. 250 miles. And besides, Euphrates is the borderland of Babylon. I mean, isn't that the people that cause all the problems anyway? I mean, isn't that the culture we're trying to avoid? Isn't that the whole problem that we're so much like Babylon and our people got so much Babylon in them anyway? And now you're telling me to go right to the edge. Walk to Euphrates, take this cloth, he says, and I want you to bury it there. So I went, verse 5, and I hid it by the Euphrates as the Lord commanded me. So he takes that linen cloth, which by then I'm sure was rather ripe, hides it, buries it under a rock by the river. And after many days, and I don't know how long that was, you can probably just guess it was a lot of time by what happens next. After many days, the Lord said to me, arise, go to the Euphrates, take from there the loincloth that I commanded you to hide there. So I went to the Euphrates, and I dug. And I dug, and I took the loincloth out, he says, from the place where I had hidden it. And now it's really nasty. And behold, the loincloth was spoiled, and it was good for nothing. Now keep in mind a couple of things here. Linen is a natural fiber. It's not going to hold up well in a wet, damp place buried in the ground. It's just not. And besides the fact that it was in pretty foul condition when he put it there, by the time he gets it, God, I'm not putting that back on. I'm not wearing that. It's nasty. It's foul. It's terrible. I mean, I can't imagine what's going through his head. This summer, I traded my truck in. I decided I wanted something cheaper and more fun to drive and better gas mileage, and I never used the truck anyway. So I said, you know what? I'm going to trade it in. Hoping I'd get myself a little extra money with the trade-in, I went real hard at getting it clean. I mean, I washed it up good from outside because it was kind of like a dump truck on the inside and got it all cleaned up. But I was frustrated because no matter what I did, the thing still smelled. I could not get the smell out of it. I mean, I worked and I worked and I worked, and there was just still this odor like, well, I don't want to offend any people group, but I mean, goodness, I mean, I've spilled some folks like this in crowded subways in foreign countries, and it didn't smell as bad as the backseat of my truck. Then finally, I traded in. I'm going through it, looking through all the last things, just making sure there's nothing I left behind. I flip the back seat up, and there in a wad is this jersey that says Auburn basketball on it. It's a practice jersey. Alex had apparently driven my truck, worn that jersey to practice, tossed it in the back seat under my seat months ago, and it smelled bad. And I'm thinking of this thing he dug out, so much worse. He digs it out, but listen to what happens. The word of the Lord came to me. Verse 9, thus says the Lord, even so will I spoil the pride of Judah and the great pride of Jerusalem. This evil people who refuse to hear my words, who stubbornly follow their own heart and have gone after gods to serve them and worship them, shall be like this loincloth, which is good for nothing. For as the loincloth clings to the waist of a man, so I made the whole house of Israel and the whole house of Judah cling to me, declares the Lord, that they might be for me a people, a name, a praise, and a glory, but they would not listen. Do you see there what you and I were made for? Do you see what you were created for? Above every other thing, whatever you like to do, whatever you're good at doing, whatever pays the bills for you to do, do you see what you were made for as one of God's people? You were made to cling to God. God has created in us innate dependence on Him. Life is not supposed to work any other way. We're supposed to grab hold of Him and not let go. We're supposed to be intimately close to Him, never separating ourselves. We're supposed to be tightly, consciously, unfailingly connected to Him. But then there's this picture of a foul loincloth. And you say, you know what, that offends me. Are you comparing me to dirty underwear? It offends me you would talk about stuff like that at church. And I think, how often are we offended at messages? How often are we offended at messengers? And how infrequently are we offended at our own sin? Does our own sin offend us anymore? Because God is painting a picture, and you know who you are in the picture? You're the loincloth, wrapped tightly around God. But God tells Jeremiah, let me give you a picture of the people. They're not clean. They're not pure. There's a lot of symbolism in this text. The type of cloth that the priest wore was linen. It was pure. It was white. It marked a special relationship with God, a special purpose to God. It marked purity in front of God. And he said, this is what my people are supposed to be. They're supposed to be my people for a purpose and a reason, but somewhere, somehow, some of us in this room, we have let go. We've let go. And there are a lot of things that we may cling desperately to. There are a lot of things that we cannot imagine living without. There are a lot of people we would not dare disappoint. There are a lot of things we can't imagine not having, but God is not one of those things. He says, you don't cling to me anymore. We thought we could do this without him. We thought we could make it on our own. We thought we could figure it out. We thought we could handle it. And why did God make us that way? What does this passage say? Well, why were we created to be this way? He says, because we were made a people by him. You who are not a people, the Bible says, have become the people of God. You were nothing. You were nobodies. But now you've been made God's people. And God had promised his people in Exodus 19, if you will indeed obey my voice, keep my covenant, you shall be a treasured possession among all peoples, for all the earth is mine, and you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. You know, God chose Israel not to the exclusion of every other nation. Do you realize that? We look at that and say, that's just not fair. I mean, why would God pick them and disregard everyone else? No, God picked them to display himself to everyone else. They were a missionary people. You're supposed to be unique. You're the people that worship the true God while they worship all this craziness and do this nonsense. You people live under rules that I've given you, and those rules are for your life, while these people live without them and destroy themselves. You people are blessed because you're obedient to me, and those people, they live under a curse because they disregard me. You are my people. I've given you my name. You're the people of God. He's given us a name. We call ourselves Christian, which could be derived as little Christ, at the very least Christ-like, those who initially were sort of mocked for being Jesus followers, and now that's the name. We're Christ's people. We're God's children. He's given us a name, and our lives are to be a praise, he says. Our lives are to praise him, that people would look at us and praise him, that our good works would be noticed by people, and in seeing our good works, they'd praise God. They would see God in it. And, of course, we're to be a glory. I mean, everything in life, that's the whole purpose. What's the purpose of your life? What's the purpose of your job? What's the purpose of your marriage? It's God's glory. Does it put a magnifier on God? Do people see God in it? Cling. And that's the whole theme, cling. When was the last time? When was the last time you were desperate for God? When was the last time you got in a wrestling match with God like Jacob did and said to God, I'm not going to let you go until you bless me? Talk about cling. God, I'm not going to stop praying until I get an answer. God, I'm not going to stop trusting until all this turns out. And God, no matter what happens to me, like Job, even though you slay me, he said, still I'm going to trust you. Man, that's clinging to him. But we don't cling anymore. We're not desperate anymore. If you're here on Wednesday night, we showed a little clip. It was just so powerful to me. I just wanted folks to hear it and see it. It was a sermon by David Wilkerson, Crossing the Switchblade, you may remember, Times Square Church. And he gave a message about anguish. That real revival and a real move of God's Spirit always comes out of anguish. And one of the things in those first several chapters of Jeremiah that God points out to his people is you don't have any anguish. Which is to say this, what you're doing doesn't affect you anymore. It doesn't break your heart anymore. And your disconnect from me doesn't do anything to you anymore. You're not moved by it. Where's the anguish? We're not desperate anymore. And we're not dependent anymore. And maybe, like the picture he paints of this people, like he painted of Judah, you're dirty. And now you're distant. And I can't use you anymore because I designed you for a purpose. And he said, here's the issue. Here's the problem. It's the chief sin under which every other sin exists, like under the shadow of its umbrella, and that's pride. Isn't that what he said in this passage? He says, it's your pride. They refuse to hear my words, he says. They stubbornly follow their own heart. They've gone after other gods. It's pride. Pride shows up like this. Here's what pride looks like. I don't listen to God anymore. I don't listen anymore. That's not to say I don't read Scripture anymore or I don't attend a Bible study anymore. I don't listen anymore. Just stop hearing. It just started to bounce off. At some point for those folks in Judah and Jerusalem, it just started to bounce off. They didn't listen to God anymore. The second thing they did is they did whatever they felt like doing. You know, they decided, I'm going to do what I want to do. It doesn't matter what God says anymore. It's that person who knows exactly what they're doing is wrong, but still struggles with the images on their computer and won't stop. It's the person who knows exactly what they're doing is wrong, but will still continue that inappropriate relationship, whether it's face-to-face or whether it's on the internet or on their phone, they won't stop. It's a person who knows and sees because they have stepped over so many barriers and run through so many warning lights, but they're on a path that's going to wreck them and their family, but they won't stop because they've decided that what they're passionate about, what they feel, is more important than what God says. And isn't that what he said of them? They follow their own heart. They stubbornly follow their own heart. They do what they want. And then he says this, their gods aren't God. It's funny today. We don't hear too many messages about idols because, well, we're not an idol culture. We're way advanced beyond that. You know, we're smart enough to know that you can't carve something and call it God. I love what Ted said. It is one of the funniest passages of Scripture where Aaron says, hey, I don't know what happened. We threw the gold in. Look what came out, a calf. Wow, imagine that. We look at them and we say, those rubes. I mean, how ridiculous can somebody be? I mean, to think that. But a God is that thing that you don't want to let go of. That a God is the thing that you think is the source of your satisfaction. A God is that piece of your life that you say, you know what, I can lose a lot of stuff, but don't take this from me. When you start to describe a God as a thing that makes you feel good, a thing you can't live without, a thing you don't want anyone to take or lose, maybe you begin to see we've got a lot of different idols here. And maybe the idols aren't so obvious. Okay, maybe if it's not job or person or hobby or activity, maybe the less than obvious God is the fact that we've taken the real God and we've carved him into something else. We made him into a God of our own liking. And so God is not even the God of the Bible. You got gods, but it's not God. And the immediate result of all of that for people of Israel is what? An exile of sort. And why? Why does God send them into exile? Why does he let the Babylonians come in and make slaves of them all and carry them off into exile? Why does he do that? To break their pride. Because the words haven't done it. The messages haven't done it. The consequences so far haven't done it. So he says, I'm going to break your pride. You know, the most merciful thing that God could ever do to you is break you. Do you know that? The most merciful thing that could ever happen to us is to be broken. Because if God breaks me, it shows me that God's not through with me. It shows me that God has not tossed me out yet. It shows that God has not declared me lost cause and written me off. If God breaks me, it shows that God does, in fact, love me. And though he may despise what I do, and it may break his heart on the decisions I make, and though I may confound everybody around me because I just don't seem to get it, God says, in mercy and love, I'm going to break you. Any of you have a testimony of God breaking you? Man, God broke me. I mean, God broke me physically. He broke me spiritually. He broke me emotionally. He broke me. When I was about 16 years old, that's when I felt this nagging sense, this growing sense. It was not burning bush, fire on the mountain. It was not one prophet putting the mantle on me and giving me a double blessing of the Spirit like Elijah to Elisha kind of thing. It was a nagging, persistent sense, this is what I want you to do. And it was a call to ministry. I knew it then. It was a time where I'd gotten serious about being a Christian, and I knew it's what God wanted me to do, so much so that He took away the desire to really to do anything else. And that stuck with me. And I got off to college, and that was my intent. That was my pursuit in school. But I was weak. And took a lot of wrong turns, and little by little, those decisions that you make that are wrong begin to make themselves, and all of a sudden you're in places you didn't think you'd be, doing things you never thought you would do, and you realize the gross inconsistency of your own life. How could God call me to do this, and I'm living like this? But of course, I really didn't see that then. That's the view you get in hindsight. I can still remember the day. It was January. It's my junior year in college. We've got some intramural games that night in the gym. It's the stuff fraternities live for. Intramural volleyball, stuff like that. Co-ed, the chicks are there and get to show off. So we're with all the guys before the thing, and we do what we often did before games. We went out and we drank. We thought we'd have more fun that way, you know, just be loose and hang out, make a joke of everything. Remember that night we played our intramural, our co-ed volleyball, and had our fun, goofed around. And at the end of this thing, me and my buddy, a guy I'd known literally since we were babies. We grew up in church together. And we just happened to end up in the same college. We're trying to dunk these volleyballs. We're just having some fun, messing around in the gym, dunking these volleyballs. I could barely do it. He couldn't do it at all. And so I said, I'll get down on my hands and knees. You jump off my back, then you can dunk it. So he did it. I said, no, let me do it. Let me jump off your back. And we did this a few times. And that kind of boring. So we said, all right, let's do this. Back up. We do it. We run and jump, and we're just having a good time. I said, all right, watch this. I'm going to dunk two volleyballs. I had him back up, and I ran. I jumped. I don't remember exactly what happened. Kind of all of a blur. But I jumped there, and the balls came out of my hand, so I grabbed the rim, and the thing breaks. Next thing I know, it's bam, I hit the floor hard. And it knocked all the wind out of me. But as I caught my breath a few minutes later, I realized my arms were really hurting. One of the trainers comes over to me, and they're trying to help me up. You know, everybody's reaching down to help me up. What I didn't realize at the time is that both my hands and wrists looked like question marks. They were just turned in a crazy sort of way. And one of the trainers looked at me and said, I think they're sprained. Well, I go to the infirmary, which is what you do when you go to a little college like we did, and the nurse does what she does and gives me Tylenol. And she says, I think you need to get those x-rayed. So, okay. We go to the hospital that night, and me and a buddy, a friend of mine, drives me there, and we're sitting there. And I hear across the room, the physician that's in there let out a very loud expletive upon looking at my x-rays. And he comes over to me and says, son, were you in a motorcycle accident? And then I felt like an idiot trying to explain to him what I did. I wanted to say I was in a motorcycle accident. That would have been a lot cooler. Turns out my arms were shattered, both bones broken in both arms, bones in my wrists like a puzzle. Next day I had about 8 hours of surgery, spent a week in the hospital after that. Had to drop out of school because I couldn't open a door or pull up a bed sheet or take a Cheeto out of a bag for about 3 months. And I look back at that time and I think, well, you know, I could easily point to, man, I was just acting the fool. There's nothing to it. It's just coincidence. Things happen. But God showed me something during that period of time that this is not who you are. This is not what I called you to be. This is not what I chose you for. Look at the life that you're living now. Look at the people that you're with. Look at what you're doing. Look at what you're throwing away. And in an instant, in a flash, God yanked me out of it. And I sure wasn't prepared for it. You can ask Cecilia. She and another friend of mine had the horrific task of coming over to my apartment and cleaning it up. And it was nasty. My kitchen was horrible. I used to cook hamburger helper, but I didn't wash up after, and that turns into something worse than this, I'll tell you. But in a flash, God yanked me out. And for a semester, I didn't get to go back. And I'm laid on my back. And I'm dependent now. I'm dependent upon my mom. I have to yell for her in the middle of the night because it's cold. It's wintertime. It's North Carolina. Mom, can you pull up my sheet? I'm cold. I had to get my knuckleheaded brother to come over and help me take a bath. You think talking about loincloths is embarrassing? I'll tell you that story later. And that's the way I live. But during that period of time, God broke me. That was my exile. Where are all my friends? Where are the people I used to hang out with and party with? Nobody came to see me. All my fraternity buddies, you know, we had this motto. I can't even remember what it was now. Something about something for life. Didn't even last 6 months. And God showed me something. And you know, I've got these scars. Sometimes people look at my hand and say, oh, what is that? Did you try to commit suicide? No, not like that. Not on the top of my wrist. But I've got a reminder. I've got a reminder of brokenness. And it was hard. Man, it was hard. Things I loved, I couldn't do anymore. Everything changed, but changed for the good. I went back to school that August. That September, Cecilia and I started dating. That summer, we got engaged. 23 years now, not bad. Would have never happened without that brokenness. And I feel sort of like this. When I read this passage like Jeremiah 13, I'm thinking, and I was this. I was the one that was saved. I was the Christian that God was trying to get messages through. I was the one that people were speaking to and mom was trying to talk to and friends were trying to warn and preachers and pastors that I had grown up with and youth pastors were trying to say, whoa, what are you doing, man? Come on, where's your head? What are you thinking? I didn't listen. God had to say, look, I'm going to put you there. I'm going to put you on the borderland of that world you want to live in. I'm going to bury you in it. That's the world you want? Go. I'm going to put you right there. And then it broke me. But when God brought me back, everything was changed. See, I think of this. What if nothing changes? What if nothing changes? I mean, what if God's trying to deal with you about some issue in your life, some pervasive sin, some hang-up, some issue, and nothing changes? You see what this passage is saying? You become useless. You become good for nothing. Now, my mom is a sweet lady. If you guys have met my mom, you would know, those of you who have. I jokingly say about my mom sometimes she's a Puritan. That's kind of the era she grew up in, you know, even though she didn't, but she would have fit. But when she get really angry at us, like when me and my brothers would be lazy and we wouldn't do what our chores, you know, where our list of chores was, particularly in the summer, my poor mom's working two jobs and she got lazy son sitting at home. So I get it now. I'm getting it all in spades. If she got really worked up, she would say, you good for nothing. Now I'm not advocating that. I don't suffer from low self-esteem. I think we've gotten way too soft today. You know, you say it to a kid today, you put them in counseling and give them medication. But, you know, you've got all these things to do. Now you're good for nothing. What are you good for? And I'm looking at this text and saying, you know, God created you for His glory. He created you and gave you His name. He created you so that your life would cause Him to be praised. He made you His people and you were nothing and He made you the people of God. And if we don't get right with Him, if we stay in this state, well, we won't stay in this state. Eventually He casts off the dirty garment. You know, it's not just a person, but a church as well. A church feels the collective effect of this as well. I mean, doesn't 1 Peter 2:9 sound a lot like Exodus 19:6? In Exodus 19:6, he tells Israel, you're my priests, you're my chosen people, you're a people after my own name. And 1 Peter 2:9, he says, you're a chosen race. He's talking to Christians, the church, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for His own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Look what I did for you. Declare it, show it, be it. You're my people. Now, this is not a name you would ever call a modern church, but it might be a name that would mark a lot of modern churches. I mean, the church of the dirty drawers looks a lot like this. The dirty loincloth church looks like this. She's got no voice. Because no one cares what she has to say. No one cares. She's got no influence on the community that she's in or the culture that's all around her. If the church of the dirty loincloth shut its doors, no one cares. It doesn't change anything. It doesn't affect anything. Because this church has got no distinction, see? And the community knows it. They know that the people in there are just like the people out here. The only difference is they think they're better, and so we mark them all as hypocrites. And God's image is not magnified, but it's a tainted image. It's a diminished image. So that church becomes good for nothing. There's a biblical term in the Old Testament called Ichabod, written over the door, because only death lives here. Why? Pride. You stop clinging. You stop being desperate. You stopped hanging on. You started living like you didn't need God. You started living like God didn't matter. You started living like you could do whatever you wanted. And you know what? It's okay. Does that sound harsh? Good for nothing? Probably does. Sound harsh when I wrote it. But that's exactly what Jesus said in Matthew 5:13. You're the salt of the earth. But if the salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out, trampled under people's feet. I'm going to take a stab at this, and I'm about to wrap up. But I wonder if some of you are in a sort of spiritual exile tonight. Stubbornly resisting what God has been saying to you. Stubbornly resisting the still small voice. Stubbornly resisting the message of Scripture that consistently comes. Stubbornly resisting the impulse of the Spirit. Stubbornly resisting the compassionate concern of a friend or a family member. Stubbornly ignoring what you already know to be so and growing more and more callous by the day. And you're in exile. And because God loves you, He'll break you there. Not because breaking us is His goal, but restoring us is. And God would rather have us limping for His glory, like Jacob did, or Israel, who got that new name and that blessing, than stubbornly standing with pride against Him. And I guess God would rather have me preaching with wrists that get sore in the wintertime because they're arthritic, than he would with the pride and ego of someone who says, God, I'm going to do what I want to do, and you're just going to have to take it. And maybe God is breaking you of your pride. Maybe you got the eyes, but you're not seeing. You got the ears, but you're not hearing. And maybe some of you don't really see, and maybe people around you do, but you don't see that your choices are starting to pile up on you. Maybe you're like those that Jeremiah referred to at the end of this chapter. Verse 22 of chapter 13. You say in your heart, why have these things come upon me? It is for the greatness of your iniquity that your skirts are lifted up and you suffer violence. I told you it was a weird message. Do you know what the imagery there is? I think God did not care much for offending the sensibilities of those religious folks in Jerusalem. He says, you're exposed. You're exposed. Your choices are exposing you. They're showing the brokenness. They're showing the distance from God. They're showing that you don't cling to Him. They're showing the desperate need. And so what do we do? What do we do when we get exposed? What do we do when we get found out? Oh, what do we do when we get discovered? What do we do when we suffer a little bit of setback or a little bit of consequence? What's natural to us? Okay, I'm going to fix it, right? I'm going to change it. I'm going to do different this time, I promise you. And some of you in this room are caught up in this horrific cycle of you know, I get caught and I feel bad and I'm going to change it this time, I promise. No, this time, this is the time, okay, I promise you this time, and it's not going to happen again, I promise. And then temptation starts to come back again, or you get tired, you're frustrated, or circumstances and pressures, and next thing you're back there again. And it's this vicious cycle, but you're losing spiritual momentum all the time. There is no perpetual motion machine here. Less and less convicted. And less receptive. And less and less sensitive. In fact, you're trying to change, but it's not working. I want to speak maybe to one person, 10 people, 20, whoever. For the person who's trying to fix it and it's not working. I'm trying to clean this mess up. I don't want to be that. No, I want to be this again. I don't know how. It's not working. Jeremiah 13:23 hits us in the face with this cold reality. Can the Ethiopian change his skin? Or the leopard his spots? Whoa, wait a minute. This flies in the face of everything I hear in culture and society today. Because people say this all the time. Can a leopard change its spots? And obviously this rhetorical question is meant to be a no. You can't change the color of your skin. It's innate. And if you're a leopard, you are what you are. That's the color, the markings that you have. Neither can you do good who are accustomed to doing evil is the way NIV renders it. ESV is a little more awkward. It's not implying you can change. In fact, it's implying the opposite. You can't. He goes on to say in verse 25, this is your lot. No, this is it, man. That's your lot. This is what you have chosen. This is what you have become. This is your lot. This is your portion that I've measured out to you, declares the Lord. Why? Because you forgot me. And you trusted in lies. You believe that life was just about being happy, didn't you? You believe that life was just about going after what you wanted. You believe that you deserved it. You believe that what you're doing didn't have any effect on anybody else. You believe that it was no big deal. You believed you could get away with it. You believed you could stop anytime. You believed you were different than everybody else, and it wouldn't affect you the same way. You believe these lies, and you forgot me. You stopped clinging to me. You've forgotten me. I want to tell you something that maybe no one has ever told you before. I don't know that it's that profound, but maybe they haven't. You can't change. You can't change. This is your lot, man. You can't change. A leopard doesn't change his spots, and you don't change the color of your skin. You can't change. God can change you. Do you see? That's where grace crosses our lives. That's the intersection of the way I'm headed and God. Because I can't change. Because Lord knows if I could have, I would have 1,000 times, and you know it to be true too. But God can change me. God can change me. I don't have the ability. I don't have the ability to reach that deep. I don't have the ability to change desires and change my heart. But God does. God can change me. But I got to cling to Him. I got to run to Him. I got to grab hold of Him. I got to say, God, don't let me go. God, whatever it is, God, I want You. I want You above everything. Verse 27 offers this question of hope and this challenge of personal responsibility. Real simple. How long will it be before you are made clean? How long will it be before you are made clean? Been reading a lot about revival, praying for revival. Why revival tarries, Leonard Ravenhill. One of the things that Leonard said is this. It's not revolutionary at all, and it's something we all know at the core. Sin. Sin is the dam that holds back the flood of revival. Because before God does any great work through us, He's got to do a healing and purifying and cleansing work in us. And lest you misread anything that I'm saying, I equate us with none of this or all of this. That's between you and God and the Spirit. But I know the revival that I need and the revival that you need won't come if I'm dirty and distant from God. It just won't. See, that passage says that a leopard can't cleanse its spots. Change its spots. It says a man can't change the color of his skin. But there's another promise in the book that just follows this one. In Ezekiel 36, God makes this promise. He says, I will give you a new heart, a new spirit I will put within you. I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh. I will give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes and be careful to obey my rules. I will do that. I can do that. In fact, this whole picture of linen that the priests wore, now it's pictured this filthy garment of Jeremiah 13. Don't you know that the bride of Christ wears that same linen? Revelation chapter 19 says the bride has made herself ready. It was granted her to clothe herself with fine linen, bright and pure, for the fine linen is the righteous deeds of the saints. You say, wait, it says she clothed herself. It's her deeds. She was granted. God changes us. Dirty underwear as a picture of me. It's kind of harsh. But listen, it's not hopeless. I can't change. I can't remedy that. If you're apart from Christ, you can't undo that. How are you going to unsin? How are you going to undo? How are you going to turn back the clock? How are you going to hit the reset? There is none. It's reality. It's your lot. All have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and the wages of those sin is death. That's your reality. That's your lot. You don't have enough ability or time to change it. And the wages of those sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life. God can change you. If anyone's in Christ, they're a new creation. He doesn't say, I'll make you better. I'll make you new, he says. I believe he's thinking of Ezekiel 36, the new heart, the new life, the new ability. God can do that. And for a Christian, if we will confess our sins, he's faithful and he's just. And he'll forgive us our sins. And what else does he say? He will cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let's pray. With you, if you're just your head bowed and your eyes closed for a minute, this music just begins to play softly for a moment. We sang a song. You heard a song a little while ago. Breakthrough. Breakthrough. You know that's not going to happen, right? Until we get real with God and we get serious about the sins in our life. It's not going to happen. We're playing a religious game, dancing around the obvious. We want this, but God says, wait, it's that. There's a normal that God created us to be. And that normal is a people, a person, a you, a me, that clings to Him. You cling to me, He says. That's why I made you. I created you to be close to me, with me, clinging to me. I created you to be a people given my name for my praise, to show my glory. That's what you were made for. That's what life's about. That's where you find satisfaction. Listen, I want you to forgo the hopelessness of self-improvement, and I want you to embrace the power of humility and God's grace. God resists the proud. That was the sin of those people. They had to be broken before they could see God. They had to be broken before God could heal them and restore them. God resists the proud. He gives grace to the humble. The beauty of these texts tonight, the story of Jeremiah, the little story of my own brokenness is this. All of us in this room can learn by hearing, or we can learn by experience. You don't have to be broken to listen, and you hear and you respond. You don't have to feel the pain that I felt or that you could feel if you'll hear and respond. If you've got something that you need to confess to the Father, if you've got something that you need to say, God, take from me. I cannot do this alone. I need you to set me free. I need you to set me free. I've been trying to fix this, and I can't fix it. Free me. I don't want to be the one cast off. I don't want to be the one buried at the edge of Babylon. I want to be close. I want to cling to you again. I want to come back and cling to you. Will you come and pray? If that's you, will you come and pray? And if you will come and pray for us all, that as a church, we'd be pure, that we'd have a voice, that we'd have influence because we're real with the Father. We're not perfect. We're not a toy with sin. We're not playing games here. Would you pray? Would you come and pray and bow and kneel? If you're coming today to say, Father, I want to cling to you again. I've let myself grow cold, indifferent, and distant. I want to cling to you. Will you come and pray? And tonight, if you've never trusted Christ, it's a weird picture I painted, I know. But man, it's just reality. The Bible says that it's not just our sins that are filthy before the Father. That makes sense to us if we really think about it. That are things we've done in secret, the things that we're ashamed of, the things we're glad no one in this room knows, it makes sense to us to say that that's like a filthy rag before God. It's a stench and an offense to Him. That we get. What we don't get is the Bible says that all of our righteousness is as a filthy rag. There's nothing good enough in me for God. Yet He loves me so much that the goodness of Christ He will give to me in exchange for my sin. I can trade in my bad for His perfect good. That's love. That's grace. That's what He's offering you. And until you get to that point of humility before the Father, I don't think you can be a Christian. I don't think you can get saved. But if you'll say to God today, listen, I get it. There's not enough in me to earn you. There's not enough good I can do. But Jesus has done it all. He's been perfect good for me. Save me. Have mercy on me, Father. Save me. If that's you, I want you to come. Father, move in us. Do with us as you will. God, I pray, whatever intent you had behind this message, whatever purpose you had behind that text, whatever you were saying to us would be heard and obeyed, that we would respond rightly. And Father, there'd be freedom as a result. There'd be healing as a result. You'd be pleased as a result. And God, in our personal lives, in our family lives, Father, we would break through. We'd move on. We'd break out of this. God, set us free tonight. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Will you stand? We're going to sing. I invite you to come if you want to find a place to pray. If you want to talk to one